Drifting over the northwest edge of the Gulf of Mexico, you can't help but notice the mosaic of ecosystems that merge to form the Texas coast. The ocean, barrier islands, bays, marshes, and rivers all combine to form habitats for a variety of plants and animals. This diversity derives from seasonal flushes of freshwater from the rivers. Without these freshwater inflows, these environmental flows, the bays would cease to thrive.
The health of the bay depends on it. I mean, the plankton growth, the grass, seagrass, the fish need it for their spawning. The salinity has to be right. For instance, if we have a real high salinity and no freshwater runoff, we don't have a crop of white shrimp that year, or a very limited crop. Of course, that's less for the fish to eat. And especially when you're dependent on having good sport fishing, it's very important, because that's what people come for. The plentiful birds and wildlife, the good fishing, and a whole lot of us make our living directly off of it.
The economy of the Texas coast is as vast as its geography. Tourism takes a variety of forms, from enjoying the beach to recreational fishing to bird watching. Add in commercial fishing, and you've got an economic engine that generates over $2 billion. Add in heavy industry, and you have a region that is critical to the welfare of the nation. The link between this vital part of the economy and the environmental flows that support it eventually attracted the attention of lawmakers.
In 2007, the Texas legislature passed two bills, Senate Bill 3 and House Bill 3, which together established a new process for trying to determine environmental flow needs of our rivers and streams and coastal bays and estuaries, and then develop standards to actually make sure that those flows are there for the benefit of fish and wildlife habitat for the future. You know, everybody, I think, understands now the value of protecting environmental flows. The question now is how to protect those flows, not whether to protect those flows.
So we finally passed the environmental flows legislation. We narrowly missed passing that in 2005. This time it came down to the very last day of the session, the very last hours, but through the heroic efforts of lots of people, the bill finally passed. What this legislation does is establish a process to determine how much water our rivers and bays need to stay healthy. We don't really know the answer to that question yet. So that's the first step under the legislation. And it involves people from throughout the different river basins in Texas who really know their own rivers. And it involves scientists from all over the state. Once we get those numbers, then those will translate into regulations that essentially cap the amount of water you can withdraw from a river basin. That's going to encourage efficiency, it's going to encourage appropriate water rates trading, and it's going to allow us to meet our future human water needs while we still keep our rivers and bays healthy for fish and wildlife, and something for future generations to enjoy.
Thank you all for being here. This is our second meeting of the Environmental Flows Advisory Group, and
we are finally overseeing this effort. Is the Environmental Flows Advisory Group, made up of lawmakers and representatives from state natural resource agencies.
Our first job was to actually appoint the Scientific Advisory Committee, which brings the hopefully objective science to the process to really study the issue and to come up with methodologies and regulations that will go towards the end of figuring out how much water needs to be available in these rivers as it gets to the estuaries. But also then we appoint the stakeholder committees for the seven major bay and estuary systems in the state, starting east and working west. So all of this input is hopefully put together at the end of the process, comes back to us, and then presented to TCEQ at the end of the day, and set up these environmental flow standards, which will apply to all of the rivers in the state.
A variety of people comprise the Bay and Basin Stakeholder Committees. Private citizens representing a particular interest, environmental groups, and water resource agencies. They will try to build a consensus and recommend what amounts of fresh water need to reach the bays.
I don't think any of us in our thinking wants to harm our environment. We don't look out there and say we have ravaged our environment in our rivers or in our bays and estuaries. The other side of that is we don't want to say that we have committed some water such that it over appropriates the environmental need and we're in effect wasting water that other interests in the state of Texas need.
What we do in one part of the state impacts what happens in other parts of the state. So it's important for us to kind of band together to understand that a little better. I think it'll be interesting to see how these processes turn out because I think they'll raise the awareness of all participants and all that rely on the rivers and the water availability in the state for all uses. Whether we use them in agriculture, whether we use them in recreation, we're all connected by this H2O molecule, this water.
Water also connects us to the natural world, and that experience alone is priceless. For some, it's the connection to water that flows continuously for hundreds of miles.
For me, the river is very special. Recreationally, it is an inspiration to me for my photography, and it's the place where I observe wildlife and make connections with that aspect of wild places. And I paddle and canoe. But more importantly, it's a sense of place. The Neches River is a sense of place for me. And perhaps even more important, it makes a connection for me with the Creator. You know, and it's this mystique of what's around the bend that you always paddle towards. And I think it's a continuing renewal, a process as you paddle and go along.
For others, the connection comes from the vastness of the Texas bays, hundreds of thousands of acres of water, some that may be only a few inches deep.
Rockport is, in my way of thinking, just really paradise. And I think anyone that came here would very quickly realize what a treasure it is. The fishing is better than anywhere in the country, and I've been all over the country and all over the world fishing, and there's not any better place or anything more pure than this. It's so singular. I mean, the quality of the water is extremely good. The wildlife is spectacular. I would suggest to you that since the whooping cranes chose this place and they're down to the last few hundred, it's pretty indicative of the purity of this area. And I spend 30 or 40 days a year here.
The way Texas is addressing the environmental flows process has never been tried before on this scale, and the results could influence how others forge environmental laws in the future.
Texas is really leading the way in the nation on environmental flows right now. This is the most comprehensive environmental flow protection statute in the country. So we need to make sure that we implement it correctly.
We are breaking new ground, if you will, with respect to defining the environmental flows of our rivers to make sure that we meet the needs of our businesses, our communities, our municipalities, and our fish and wildlife, and all those who value and enjoy those resources. And so the eyes of the nation are definitely upon Texas, and that's where we like them, because this is an opportunity for us to shine, and I have no doubt we will when it comes to the future of our rivers.